Well, thank you very much, and hello, Las Vegas. Great to be with you. They have a big election tomorrow. We've already won the state. We've already won. I like ours better. We just take it. Just take it. We want it. I like it that better. You know, they say they're going to have a lot of problems tomorrow. I hate to tell you this. I don't know. Have you heard? I hear their computers are all messed up, just like they were in Iowa. They're not going to be able to count their vote. They're going to tell you about health care. They're going to tell you about our military and the jet fighters and the missiles and rockets. But they can't count votes. They just can't count them. They can't count votes. But they're saying they may not be able to do it again. They're still trying to tell us. I called up yesterday. How are they doing in Iowa? Was that 2 weeks ago? They say, we're getting close. They're not getting close. They'll never know. They'll never know. But I hear the same thing could happen tomorrow. I hope it doesn't, actually. I hope it doesn't. But I'm delighted to be back in a state I love. I have a beautiful building right down the road with the proud, hardworking patriots of Nevada. You got to say Nevada. You say that wrong, you got problems. You say Nevada, they go, what the hell? Got to be Nevada. With your help this November, we're going to defeat the radical socialist Democrats, and we are going to win Nevada in a big, beautiful landslide. Now, we have some special people here. You know, the special people are all of you. That's who the special. But we have some very special people, and we celebrate one of the greatest moments in the history of sports. Some people say it was the single greatest moment in the history of sports. It was called the Miracle on Ice. Do you remember that? That was when the Russians had a team assembled that was probably, they say, maybe the greatest team ever assembled. They were unbelievable. And, you know, our guys played a practice game with them. Was it like a couple of weeks before? And I hate to tell you, the score was 10-3, and the USA was not on top. And this team was an incredible team, and they went in, and it was amazing. But tomorrow marks the 40 years since the United States men's hockey team defeated then Soviet Union team in the 1980 Olympics. Incredible. That was incredible. Most of you remember that. I'm looking at, we got a lot of young ones, but we got a lot of people that remember that. A lot of people. And by the way, we got the Olympics coming back, coming to Los Angeles. Thank you. Thank you, President Trump. Thank you, President Trump. Thank you very much. Thank you, President Trump. 8 years. 8 years, 2028. And you know what? Unless I'm still president then, which is a distinct possibility, I won't be here. And you know what they'll do? I'll say, how's the Olympics going? Does anybody have a ticket for the president that got the Olympics to come here? They'll say, I want to thank, and they'll thank hundreds of people, but they won't thank you, President, and I'm the one that pulled it off. But that's okay. 2028 Olympics is coming to Los Angeles. It's going to be great. And we worked with the mayor of Los Angeles. He was great. He called up, and we gave him a lot of help. I was president-elect then because the president didn't want to get involved. He didn't want to get involved in getting the Olympics, so they called me, and I was president-elect, hadn't taken office. Then I got involved, and I'll tell you, they were happy we got involved. It was great. It's going to be very exciting. Today, we are thrilled to have with us 14 players of that really incredible gold medal team. Give them a big hand. And they were amazed. They said, boy, this is a big crowd. I said, it's only because you guys are coming. You know, this thing was supposed to be for this evening. And I said, let me get back to Washington. Do it early. So we gave you almost no notice. You have thousands of people outside, thousands of people inside. You had to see. We were in Iowa. We were in New Hampshire. You saw what happened in Colorado last night. It was unbelievable. Every place we go, it's the same. It's been incredible. I don't know if you saw in the pictures last night of the outside in Colorado. It was incredible. It was, you could have filled that arena four times, and it was a big arena. And it's something. So I hated to do it to you at 12 o'clock, but I said, let's go. I want to get back. We got to deal with China. We got to deal with Russia. We got to deal with North Korea, South Korea. We got to deal with the rest of the world. Get my people back. We got to get the hell out of here, right? But we have a lot of time. I'd like now to invite these incredible sport legends to join me on stage. A friend of mine and a very good golfer, by the way, Captain Mike. Mike. Where's Mike? Where is he? Mike. You know who he is? He's a fake handicap is what he is. Say something, Mike.
Just welcome everybody. It's ironic we happen to be here to celebrate our 40th anniversary. The Vegas Knights flew the whole team out to honor us tonight and for the weekend. And we obviously thank the people of Las Vegas for having us here. And we're looking forward to celebrating a special time. And it's a great honor for the president to invite us to be part of this event as well. So, Vegas, thanks for having us.
But just tell them, am I a good athlete and am I a good golfer?
Yeah, you are, yes, sir. Whatever you say.
Thanks, Mike. That was some goaltending, right? How many did you rebuff? I mean, but how many did he do?
Very few,
but a lot of shots, right?
Yes, a lot of shots.
He was like a piñata.
Yes.
So, Mike, that was great. Goaltender Jim Craig. So, Jim rebuffed. Come here, Jim. Great goaltender. They didn't know what was happening. They kept shooting. He doesn't know how many you rebuffed. How many did you rebuff?
37.
Wow. So let me ask you, was that, as goaltender, because that was incredible, was that the greatest game you ever played? You've had a lot of great games, but was that the greatest game you've ever played?
It was an important game.
That was slightly important.
Yes. Thank you.
37. 37! Bill Baker. Bill, come up. Bill Baker, Dave Christian, Ken Morrow, Jack O'Callaghan, Mike Ramsey, those legs took a beating. Mark Wells, Neil Broughton, John Harrington, Rob McClanahan, Buzz Schneider, Dave Silk, Phil Vercata, and a great coach, an assistant coach at the time, Craig Patrick. Said 4 more years. 12 more years left for them. Look at that. Look at the press. Look, hey, Mike, look at the fake news back there. It's a lot. I always say, that's like the Academy Awards used to be. This year we had a movie. They said, best movie. They announced a movie from South Korea. I said, what's that all about? The movie was made in South Korea. Look, I get along great with South Korea, but you know, I never saw that one before. They used to call it best foreign movie. But now we do it that way. I don't get it, but that's what it used to be. And this is really an incredible time. I'll tell you what, for our country, that's why I like to see things that we do get honored, because nobody is doing what we do. Nobody can do it like us. We're the greatest country in the world again. We have the greatest people. We have the greatest military by far. We've totally rebuilt our military. Jobs are booming. Incomes are surging. Poverty is plummeting. Factories are returning. Confidence is soaring like these guys. The confidence is soaring. But, you know, we do have somebody that I'd like to point out, because this team is, they had a coach. And that coach was a very inspirational coach, would you say, Mike? And I'd like to have maybe one of you come up and just say a few words about Coach Brooks, because he was he was really a big, he was a big heart on this team. Please.
Who'd like to say?
I think it would be appropriate, if you got a few minutes, that Herb Brooks' daughter, Kelly, is here representing her father. And I can honestly tell you that Kelly was not ready for this at all. You got it? Her dad was an amazing coach. He was a great teacher. He was a great motivator, at times maybe too much of a motivator. He was very demanding. He was very difficult to play for. But trust me on one thing, there never once was a day that we didn't respect the man. And never once was a day that we didn't trust him and what he was trying to do. He orchestrated the greatest sports moment of the 20th century. And the guys behind me were so proud and honored to have been a part of him and what he was able to put together. It was a perfect environment, a perfect storm sometimes. Not only a great coach, but great players and great people that stand behind me now. So if Kelly would like to say a couple of words, come no, on, she won't.
Thank you. I'm honored that his legacy still is alive today, and he would be proud to be here with you all. In my personal opinion, he would have been a Trump fan.
So tell me one thing. So I see those tears. That means you think you miss him and you love him, right? Was he actually a nice guy? Because he looked tough. Mike was just saying he was brutal. But he was a good guy, right? Tough, but great. Thank you very much. Thanks, Kelly. Thank you all. Greatest sports story could be number one. People, a lot of these sports experts, sports writers have voted that as the single greatest sporting event or athletic achievement. I think so, yeah. They put it number one, certainly top five in the history of our country. We have a lot of things that we've done to break records. We're going to go over them, but we've broken a lot of records now. But I want to thank that great team for being with us, very inspirational. This is a big day, the anniversary. Thank you, fellas. Thank you. In my State of the Union address, I proudly declared that we are in the midst of the great American comeback, and we're just getting started. After 3 years of ridiculous witch hunts and partisan Democrat crusades. By the way, I think they're starting another one. Did you see that? I see these phonies, the do-nothing Democrats. They said today that Putin wants to be sure that Trump gets elected. Here we go again. Here we go again. Did you see it? A story. Aren't people bored? Now, does that include, because a couple of weeks ago, Crooked Hillary said Chelsea Gabbard, right? Tulsi Gabbard, and, right? She was a Russian agent, Tulsi. And also, Stein, from Jill Stein. I don't know Jill Stein. I never met the woman. She is a Green Party candidate, or was. They said she's an agent of Russia. I don't know her, and I don't know Tulsi. The only thing I know about both of them is they're not agent. They are not agents of Russia. These people are sick. That's pencil neck. Pencil neck again. Little pencil. No, I just see it again. I was told that was happening. I was told a week ago. They said, you know, they're trying to start a rumor. It's disinformation. That's the only thing they're good at. They're not good at anything else. They get nothing done. Do nothing, Democrats. That Putin wants to make sure I get elected. Listen to this. So, doesn't he want to see who the Democrat's going to be? Wouldn't he rather have, let's say, Bernie? Wouldn't he rather have Bernie, who honeymooned in Moscow? Wouldn't that be? These people are crazy. That's all they think about. They don't think about the country. They don't think about jobs. They don't think about lowering your drug costs. Infrastructure. These people are crazy. Trust me. I like what we're doing, and I love this country. I love this country. Now, and I campaigned on it. At the same time, we want to get along with Russia. We want to get along with China. We want to get along with all these countries. Who the hell needs to have conflict? But these people are sick. They are sick people. The radical left's attempts to poison our democracy and overturn the last election have totally ended in a big, fat failure. And by the way, you saw today? Single best day I've ever had in the polls. And any poll that the fake news gives you, because the real numbers are higher, but any poll they give you is a fake. But Wisconsin, the great state of Wisconsin, I was leading by many, many, many points against every one of these characters. Can you believe it? We got a new one, Mini Mike. How did he do in the debate the other day? Mini Mike! Here's a box, Mike. Here, Mike. Boom. Mini Mike, he was a beauty. What happened? He couldn't breathe. What happened? Mike would like to know. How about that Pocahontas screaming at him? She forgot. She forgot that she lied about her own heritage. She said she was an Indian because she had high cheekbones. That was the only thing. Remember when I said, I have more Indian blood in me than she has, and I have none. Right? I have none. To the best of my knowledge. Wouldn't mind having some, but I happen to have none. And she choked and she went out and got a report done. 1/1024. You know what that means? That means probably I do have more. Now, why didn't he bring that up when she was screaming at him? Why? Because he was gasping for breath. I can't breathe. He's going, I can't breathe. She's hitting me too hard. Pocahontas. Well, she won that debate because Mike could not respond. That's what they all said. They all said that. That's funny. I was. They're all shouting. It's not me that's saying it, fake news. You fake news people. No. No. They all said it, though. Who won the debate? Trump. You know what? The way I look at it, when fake news CNN, oops, there goes the camera off. Red light just went off. See, I can tell every one of them. I know them by heart. I know the operators. I know the cameramen. They're okay. They're all on our side, by the way. They're screamed at. Get that camera off. I don't want to do that. Get that camera off. It's going to be a job. All right. I'm sorry, President Dick. But how about MSDNC? They're worse than CNN. And they're owned by people that really are bad. I think they're very bad for our country. The owners of Comcast, rotten company, bad for our country, very bad. They try, you know, they have all these PR things to try and keep their image nice and clean. What they do on television is so disgusting. I think in the old days you had to have licenses for this stuff, right? They can say whatever they want to say. Let's see what happens over the next period of time. Bunch of dishonest people. Comcast, terrible company, terrible people running that company. And you know what? I had Celebrity Apprentice. I had The Apprentice on for 14 seasons. 14 seasons. And they used to come to my office and they would kiss my ass. Please sign. Please sign. Please. Please sign. You know, it's an interesting story. They came and we signed. You know who signed me? Jeff Zucker. It's one of the only things he's done good in broadcasting. But I signed, and NBC, as you know, is owned by Comcast. But I signed, and they figured the show would be a total failure, so they only signed me for one season. You know, I was going to have it. It was going on. And then the show goes, started at 10, went to 8, went to 7, went to 5. Went to 4, went to 2. It went to 1. I had the number one show on all of television. Number one. It was a phenomenal, phenomenal. And the final episode, remember that? Do you remember that? Do you remember the final? It was like one of the biggest shows of the year. It was a tremendous success. But here I was. I signed with NBC. And they didn't even want to waste the ink on an option. Usually they have an option for not, you know, just like, they didn't do it, you stupid people. So they paid me very little for the first season. I think $25,000 a show, which is, you know, considered like not good. That's okay, it was fun. I didn't know it was going to be successful. You know, hey, just like this was successful. It's a reason. Because when I left, and Arnold Schwarzenegger, and I like Arnold said some very nice things the other day, so I'm not, but the show did not exactly succeed when I left. But I had it on, and they wanted me to sign for more, and I said, no, I'm going to run for president. But I'll never forget, I didn't know anything about this, right, the business, and I had an agent, wonderful guy from William Morris. And he said, sir, I don't want you to sign. No business show has ever done well on network television. I said, well, it's not business. It's entertainment. It's a lot of... Sir, I don't want you to sign. Sir, don't sign. I said, yeah, okay. But I have a problem. I shook the hand of somebody. I have to. And Mark Burnett was great. He was my guy. But we shook hands, so I have to. But I agreed, you know. I didn't know that no business type show had ever succeeded on a network television. So he said, I don't want you to sign, sir, break it. I said, I can't break it, can't break it. Anyway, so the show, I said, started at 10, went to 9, it was the number one show all of a sudden. And the agent called me up. And he said, sir, I remember it was 6 in the morning, I was in bed. He said, sir, the show just went to number one. I'd love to see you because I think I'm entitled to more money. I said, you didn't want me to do the show. Well, not really. I mean, I was okay. He said, I'd really like more money. I said, Jim, I like you very much. Jim, you're fired. Get out. Anyway, I had 14 great seasons over about 11 years because it was so successful. They kept it. They would have run it. Remember when they did the 3 hours? The whole night was The Apprentice. They said, wait a minute. Gone with the Wind, to mention the movie the second time. Gone with the Wind is shorter. They had The Apprentice run for 3 hours. I said, even I can't, it's too long. You can't put it on for three. You got to leave them a little bit like, I want to come back next week. But they had it on for 3 weeks. We did fantastically with it. Comcast did great. NBC did great. They wanted me to sign for another 3 years. I said, no, I'm going to run for president. And that was actually the time when I knew I was going to run. Because, you know, they were paying a lot of money. And whether you're rich or not, it's still a lot of money. I don't care how rich you are. It's a lot. It's millions and millions of dollars. And I said, no, I'm going to run for president. And I did that. But from the day I ran, they went from being, you know, wonderful. They were nice. They were, you know, they were nice. I guess if I didn't do well with the show, they wouldn't have been nice because they weren't nice to other people that failed. You know, people that didn't have good ratings. That business is a very simple business. If you have good ratings, you can treat them like garbage. If you have bad ratings, you can say, sir, I really respect you so much. Get out of here. Get them out of my office. They're very ruthless people. But Comcast is a rotten company. They forgot totally. And they are worse than CNN. I will tell you that right now. Comcast is worse than CNN. We should call it Comcast because that's their beautiful maiden name, Comcast. They're worse than CNN. I'll tell you something about CNN. Jake Tapper today, he put out, now I know you don't like him. I know who likes him? Who the hell can like him? I think his wife likes him, actually. I really believe she does. But let me just tell you, he put out a couple of social media posts today, because I never call it tweet. I call it social media, because it's much bigger than tweet. What we have, Dan Scavino, the great Dan Scavino, we have on 5 sites. We're number one on Twitter. We're number one on Facebook in the whole world, in the whole world. So it's powerful. But Jake Tapper put out some things basically saying, I believe it. That's the way I read it. That the new Russian thing that started yesterday, that Putin wants to be sure that Trump wins. Give me a break. Give me a break. But Jake Tapper said, it ain't so. And if he did say that, because they were a little complex, you know, they can turn him around. Or when Zucker sees him and said, why did you put that? I want that deleted and I want you to do a different one. But he did say that, so I respect that, because it's another hoax story. But we're standing up for the defense of our Constitution, for our freedom, and democracy itself. You know that, okay? That's what we're doing. I gotta get that. Hey, Bobby, see that guy? I love this shirt. Bobby, I don't know, he looks like a nice guy. Can you please walk him up, even if you have about 5? Come here. Come here. You got to see this shirt. I love it. I'm going to order me one that I can ride around. Come on up here. He looks safe. He doesn't look like he's going to start a fist fight. He's a good fan, I guess. You got to see this shirt. I love it. Is there any place that's more fun than a Trump rally, right? How many rallies have you been to?
Huh? 80.
He said 80 rallies. Come up here. Come on. Look at these two guys. These guys are serious. These are serious fans, right? Are you with him? You're with him. Come up here. Man. Wow. I just said, how long have you two been together? I figured they'd say, you know, we're married.
He met her at the rally in Colorado. Can you believe this? Do you believe it? Man, did he get lucky. They both got lucky, right? They both got lucky. Well, it's cool. No, I just see there's so much stuff out here. It's genius, actually. While the extreme left has been wasting America's time with vile hoaxes, we've been killing terrorists, creating jobs, raising wages, enacting fair trade deals, securing our border, lifting up citizens of every race, color, religion, and creed. As you heard, we added another 225,000 new jobs last month alone, way above anticipated schedule. And that makes 7 million new jobs since the election. The number was supposed to be under 2 million, and we added 7 million. And remember, if I give you wrong numbers, the fake news is going to have headlines. Trump gave you wrong. I mean, it's very tough. I've got to be very careful. Even if I give you wrong in the wrong way, they'll say it was wrong. I said, yeah, but it was wrong in the low way. No, that's no good either. Got to be exactly very precise with these characters. The Democrats don't have to be, but we have to be. We've destroyed the ISIS territorial caliphate 100%. We killed the founder and leader of ISIS. Al-Baghdadi is dead. Al-Baghdadi is dead. 17 years they looked for him. 17 years. Al-Baghdadi, one of the first things I did when I came in, you know, he's the founder of ISIS. And when I came in 3 years ago, ISIS was all over the place. And I said, you got to knock it out. We knocked it out of Syria and Iraq and other places. We really knocked it 100%. Remember, I wanted to leave. I said, all right. We were at 96%, then 98, then 99%. I said, let some of these other countries do it, wouldn't you say, right? So what happened is I wanted to leave, and they said, no, 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 we want 100%. So we wait and stayed. We got 100%. Then we moved them all out of Syria, except we did keep the oil. You noticed that, right? We kept the oil. Sorry. They said he left soldiers in Syria. Yeah, I did, to keep the oil, if you don't mind, which is what we should have done in Iraq, too, by the way. I would have done that and making a lot of money with all that oil. But you remember that whole thing, that whole, I said, you got to find Al-Baghdadi. I've been saying that actually for 2 years. I had a lot of other things to do the first year, like fight off the Democrats, these crazy Democrats, with their hoaxes. With their hoaxes. Think of it. If they use their genius, because they are genius at that stuff, right? They're really good. They can take nothing. They can take a perfect phone call made to the Ukrainian president who said very specifically there was no pressure. He doesn't even know what's going on. And they can take this perfect call. Thank goodness I had a transcriber. Do you agree with that? Because the fake whistleblower said that the call was totally different than what the call was. So when I released the call, when I released the transcripts, they died. They said, oh, we got a problem. They never thought I was going to do it. But I had no choice. I had to, because I had to show they're liars. But think of it. They can take something like that, a perfect phone call, or they'll take just out of thin air, they can make something up. And they ended up today, front page, New York Times. They used to call it the eighth column. That's the big column on the right. I don't know. The paper's become so small, I don't know if they have an eighth column anymore. They used to have the eighth column was the big deal, right? That was the big deal. Today, it's too narrow. I think they're probably, after I'm gone, they won't have any columns. That's why eventually they're going to support me. Eventually, the Times and the Washington Post, which will be dead as a doornail after I leave, and the CNN, it'll be an obsolete business, the cable business. MSDNC will be out of business. You know, cable was supposed to be obsolete, and now they're doing the highest numbers they've ever done. If an airplane goes down with 700 people, they don't cover it. If it's not Trump-related, they don't cover it. It's got to be Trump or Trump-related. So if a plane goes down and it's total devastation, if a ship goes down, if the Titanic If the Titanic equivalent went down, they wouldn't cover it, unless I was on the sucker. They wouldn't cover it. The fake news would not cover the equivalent of the Titanic. But you know what they're going to do before the election? They're going to say, we want to just say something. We're going to endorse the president. You know why? Because they'll be out of business. Can you imagine if they had to cover Minnie Mike, who I think he's gone. But you know what? He'll spend another $500 million. Don't forget, I spent $70 and I won of my money. In other words, they said, and this was in the New York Times. I said it the other night in Colorado. I spent $70. Minnie Mike so far has spent almost $500 million in order to get embarrassed by Pocahontas. Pocahontas. And she's mean, isn't she? Do you see the anger on her face? That nervous energy? She's like jumping up and down. She's a mess. But no, she's mean, right? Right? See, that face is just, she wanted to get him. She said, I got him. I want to see those agreements. You open up those agreements. This poor guy probably signed 100 of them. And each one's a disaster. He said, I don't want to open those agreements. Nobody told me this was going to happen. He said, nobody told me. Get me out of here. You know, after the debate, he went backstage, fired a lot of people. He said, how the hell did you get me into this thing? But anyway, but Pocahontas was really mean. But she's going to be easy. I hope it's her. It's not going to be her. She made a little comeback the other night because she took Minnie Mike to the cleaners. But it's not going to be her. It can't be Buttigieg. Can't be, I don't think. Alfred E. Newman. Ladies and gentlemen, introducing President Alfred E. Newman. But see, nobody knows because you're all too young. Nobody knows who Alfred E. It's Mad Magazine. They all said, no, howdy doody. See, nobody knows who Alfred E. Newman is. Only the real aficionados, they're the ones and they love it. But that's only 15% of the crowd, right? Am I right? Better than howdy doody, howdy doody. But he's got to learn, you know, he's got to worry about his own city. It's going to hell, so he's got to worry because that city's got a lot of problems. I don't get the whole thing. But he's not a bad debater, I will say. He's probably the best up there. Bernie is too emotional. He's screaming, going crazy. And Biden is angry. Biden is angry. Everything's anger. Gee. And that's what happens when you can't get the words out. No, it does. That's what happens, right? When you can't get the words out, you get angry. You get angry because you can't get the words out. Might happen to me someday. Can you imagine if that happened to me? Man, would I be a bad guy. I'd be the meanest man in history. No, but Biden is very angry. You know, he gets angrier and angrier and angrier. He's changed. And then you have that time, yeah, he said Tom Steyer. Tom said, Mr. Impeachment, how did that work out, Tom? Thank you very much for the great poll numbers between him and Nervous Nancy. How did that work out? This schmuck spends $250 million. He ends up with 0.3% in Iowa, but maybe, that could be rigged because they still don't have any idea what he got. Maybe he won Iowa. They took it away from him. No, but he was substantially below. It said, all I know, it said 1% and a narrow left. So he spends $250 million, Tom Steyer. Never heard of this guy. Who is he? Where did he get his money? Who is he? You know, he was in the coal business. Did you know that? This guy, this phony, is a big environmentalist. He made his money, a lot of it, in the coal business. Nobody knows that, but he's a fake. Remember when he walked up to Bernie the other day? Hi, Bernie. Hi. Oh, and he was having a fight with Pocahontas, right? Is this the greatest? Mark Burnett said, this is the greatest reality show in history. He said, you can take The Apprentice, and you can take Survivor, and you can take every other reality show ever made, multiply it times 10,000, and you still don't have what we have. And even the cast, he did say this. You got the perfect president, You got the perfect first lady. How about the first lady? You got the perfect kids. The kids, though, those beautiful kids. My beautiful kids, they had such a great life before I did this. Sorry, kids. Sorry. My beautiful Ivanka, she had such a great life. She had a company that was selling shoes and everything you could sell. She just put her name on it. And she said, Daddy, it doesn't matter. I want to come to Washington and help people get jobs. Right? Isn't that true? And she left the company. And, you know, when you leave a company, all of a sudden it doesn't do as well. I wouldn't say that I exactly helped, talking about the wall and other things. But she left the company, came to Washington, and she said 500,000 jobs. That was her goal. And she did that in the first month. She actually did. She's gotten these great companies like Walmart and many others, Exxon. She's gotten them to take millions of people. She's now over 15 million jobs where they train people and bring them into the companies. It's incredible. 15 million! And she's smart. You know, she's got it figured out, but not most people can't, but she does. But all they do is give them heat. They work so hard. And could you imagine, you take Biden's son. Can you imagine? You know, I deal with all these big companies in these great, great countries. I think I could get my son's 25 board chips for millions of dollars apiece. My kids would be mad. But you know what? We don't do any of that stuff. We don't do that stuff. We don't do it. The kid got $3 million, $83,000 a month, and he didn't have a job until his father became vice president. And speaking of vice presidents, okay? And speaking also of reality television, because it's the greatest show of all time, right? Look at this guy. Look. We told you what, last night? Little change, folks. We're going to move it up from 8 o'clock in the evening till 12 o'clock in the afternoon. Little change, just a minor change. Because I have to get back to Washington and work. I feel guilty. This is too much fun. But speaking of vice presidents, and speaking of perfect vice presidents, you know, if you become president, the first thing you have to do is choose a really horrible, horrible vice president. So if the idiots ever want to impeach you, they have to say, I can't impeach him. Look who we have. I have the perfect vice president. I have the greatest in the world. I have the greatest vice president. I don't know. I got the great ones. I said, you know, I can't do that. I picked a great guy. He's done a fantastic job. He's been a great vice president. But it is true. I could have picked, I'll give you names, but I don't want to do that because I don't want to hurt anyone's feelings. But there are plenty of them out there, mostly out there. And I don't want to do that. But Mike Pence has been great. But tell me, is it perfect casting? The whole thing. And this isn't about casting. This is about real life. But when Mark Burnett said to me the other day, he said, the greatest reality show of all times, times a million. And he's, that's exactly, except for one thing. We work our asses off, and we are doing things like nobody has ever done before. Nobody. Right? Right? So we took out al-Baghdadi, and then we just took out 2 weeks ago the world's top terrorist, Qasem Soleimani of Iran, ending his evil reign of terror forever. He's the father of the roadside bomb. When you see our beautiful people walking around with no legs, they're walking and trying to walk so hard, and they're really in rough shape. They have incredible the job the doctors do at Walter Reed in some of these hospitals. And they get them to a point where sometimes they really can. They walk around, but it's hard. And they lose legs and they lose arms. That was Soleimani. He's the father of the right. He loved the roadside bomb. He thought it was a great thing. Where is he now? Soleimani. And I'll tell you what, you know who's happy about it? The people of Iran are happy, and even the leaders of Iran, because the leaders of Iran were afraid of him, okay? And the fact is, America is respected again. We're winning. We're winning all over. We're winning in Washington. The Democrats keep losing their minds. That is why millions of registered Democrat voters are leaving their party to join our movement. It's not even a party, it's a movement. They're joining the Republican Party. It's true, we have a lot of, look at the energy in this room. They're all fighting. They're all fighting. We're a unified party. The Republican Party has never been unified like it is today. I mean, I'll show you. I could say we're going to go over to the Hilton, or we're going to go over to someplace, and we're going to do a rally at 8 o'clock tonight. We'd have tens of thousands of people there. There's never been this. You know, Ronald Reagan was great. I thought he was a great guy, great president, didn't like his policy on trade. That's okay, trade. But if he came to Las Vegas, you know, they'd have a ballroom, they'd have 500, maybe 1,000 people. What we're doing, and this isn't even, I must say this, I don't want to tell you this, this is not election season, because we're 9 months away. You know, election season is when you're 2 months away. We're not even in election season, and we have more enthusiasm now, believe it or not, than we had even before the election in 2016. Too early. It's true. We have a great gentleman and woman with us, a friend of mine, Mr. and Mrs. Sheldon Adelson, right over here. Great, great person. Two great people. He's got so much money, he doesn't know what the hell to do with it. He owns the Sands Hotel. That's like one of his smaller businesses. Sheldon, that's like your small business, right? He is a great guy. She's an incredible woman. She's a doctor. And she studies addiction and drugs, drug addiction, all sorts of addictions. And she knows more about that subject, I think, than anybody. And she works hard, and she doesn't need it. He does not need the money that she brings in, okay? He also happens to own the paper. He owns the paper. You own the paper in town, right? They wanted like a couple of $100 million too much. He said, give it to them. It's peanuts. What the hell difference is it? But we want to thank the Adelsons. They've been incredible fans, and they love Israel. They love Israel. I just saw him sitting there. I didn't know they were here. I just see him sitting there. He's something. The chairman of the Nevada Republican Party, who's really been great. He's been with me for a long time, and he's a very committed man. Make America great again. You know this. Oh, let's do a poll quick, just quick. You know, I'll never get rid of MAGA because I'm superstitious. But you know, we just hit an all-time high with the stock market. Our military is rebuilt. You just got the greatest tax cuts in history, the greatest regulation cuts, and all of this stuff. So let me ask you this. So make America great again, sort of doesn't work quite as well. So now we have keep America great. And we have the new hat, higher, well, stiff. It's like a billboard, right? I call it the billboard. It's a billboard. So let's go. Just out of curiosity, I am very surprised by it. We're going to keep them both, but I'm just curious, if we did go to one, make America great again. Keep America great. I would have said that's impossible. Make America great again is the greatest phrase. A lot of people, again, fake news, I think, will agree to it. It's the greatest phrase ever used in politics. It's the greatest phrase. Now, who has the greatest phrase ever used in the history of politics and say, oh, let's go with a new phrase, right? But we're going to keep, so we have to keep MAGA. But now we have CAG. Now we have CAG. So we have them both. I just don't have the courage to get rid of the one who would be too disrespectful. Too disrespectful. But Michael McDonald, I want to thank you and the members of the Nevada Republican Central Committee. You're all here. You're great people. And a man came here. He loves us. He's been with us. Rick Harrison of the world famous gold and silver pawn shop. Rick Harrison. You better win, Michael, otherwise that's the last time I'm introducing you like that. I hear we're up. I hear we're doing nicely. I hear we're doing great. And by the way, the union, I have a lot of respect for that union. You know, last time I had a strike in my building during the election. It's the only reason we would have won this state. I'm like brilliantly, to save 3 cents. I could have settled the strike before the election. I wanted to save $2. Total. That was a brilliant move. And then we had some guy running, a guy named Hecht. And he wasn't too good. He didn't do too good. But we almost won the state despite, I had a big strike. I had thousands and thousands of union guys. They had, they wanted, wanted to show us. But I think that the unions are really with us. And the unions have been with us, the Teamsters, so many of the unions. Because I'm for the working man and woman, whether you're union or non-union. Some states are all union, some states are no union, but we get them all, and I think we're going to have tremendous success. And, a lot of the Democrats are going to ruin the health care programs that these unions have. The unions have worked hard on health care, and they're going to ruin them. They're going to take away, you're going to lose 180 million people off of great private health care. So we'll see what happens, but a lot of the Democrats want to do that. They think it's wonderful. But together, we're building the world's most prosperous economy and the most inclusive society. That's true. Since my election, over 125,000 new jobs have been created right here in Nevada, including over 40,000 new Nevada manufacturing and construction jobs, a 30% increase. The national unemployment rate is the lowest in over half a century, and soon we're going to have that be a historic number like so many of the others. The average unemployment rate for my administration, this is the coolest of them all, is the lowest for any United States president in recorded history. That's pretty good. That's pretty good. When I'm in a debate, they're saying, we're going to do this. I said, listen, we have the best unemployment numbers in the history of our country. African-American unemployment, Hispanic-American, we got a lot of Hispanic. I love Hispanic. Who in this audience is Hispanic? Yeah. We're doing great. Well, we should be doing great. You have the lowest ever recorded, lowest unemployment rates ever recorded. Asian Americans, likewise, the lowest ever recorded. The unemployment rate for women reached the lowest rate in 71 years. African American youth unemployment has reached an all-time historic low. People I love, people I might have helped more than anybody because of choice and accountability. The veterans' unemployment rate dropped to the lowest record employment, lowest in history. The unemployment rate for disabled Americans has reached an all-time historic low. And you got to remember, they're back there checking every word. They're going, oh, my God, oh, he's right. He's right. He's right. I can't say it because I got all these maniacs back there. They're trying to fight. You know, he put the comma in the wrong place. He didn't make that word plural. Therefore, he lied. He lied. Now, I got to be very accurate because all these numbers, they check them out as they check them. They're in there checking out. Check on the African-American unemployment, please. Please tell me. Please tell me it's not historic. These people are among the most dishonest human beings on earth. Not all of them. Not all of them. Workers without a high school diploma. We have millions of people that didn't go through high school. They left. They had problems. Good problems, bad problems, families where they don't have the money. They didn't get a high school diploma. They've achieved the lowest unemployment rate ever recorded in the history of the United States. Those are important groups of people. 500,000 more Hispanic Americans now own a home. No, Hispanic have done so good. And by the way, you know who understands the border? Because we are building that wall like crazy. You know who understands? Remember, they all said, oh, if you build the wall, you lose the Hispanic vote. I said, I got to do what's right. You know who understands the border better than anybody? You know who understands crime at the border better than anybody? The Hispanics understand it. And they don't want to be working and have people come and take their job, have people come in where they can't pay for their house, have people come in who are very, very bad people. You have some very bad people. You have murderers and rapists, and we have set all sorts of records at the border. But we're up to 122 miles of wall. And it is true. The people that understand it the best are Hispanic. So thank you. Gotta make our country safe. Gotta make our country safe. We've lifted 10 million people off of welfare. Median household income is now the highest ever recorded in our country. Think of that. President Bush, I say it all the time. President Bush, 8 years, $450. President Barack Hussein Obama. 8 years, 8 years, $975. President Donald John Trump, 3 years, it's actually less when they did the numbers, 3 years, including the big tax cuts that we got you and the regulation cuts, 3 years, so you had $450, $975, that's 8 and 8. Now we're down to 3 years, a little less, 3 years, $10,000 per family. A year, $10,000 a year. Our historic regulatory reduction campaign is restoring American liberty and ending the tyranny of federal bureaucrats. I deal with them, they're not good, it's called the swamp. We've ended the war on American energy, lowering utility bills, reducing prices at the pump, reducing your prices. Part of that number is all of the money that we save at the pump and on electric. I also recently took action on an issue Nevada has been dealing with for over 30 years, Yucca Mountain. Do you know Yucca Mountain? My budget stops funding for the licensing of waste storage at Yucca Mountain so that we can focus on positive solutions and for much better reasons and alternatives. Why should you have nuclear waste in your backyard? Why should you have nuclear waste in your backyard? I won't say which countries, but you know what other countries do? I will not say which ones. They put it on a ship, they float it out into the middle of the ocean, they find a nice deep spot, and they dump it. That's the end of it. But we would never do that for environmental reasons. We are reversing decades, so Yucca Mountain, you're okay, please, okay? Just relax. You have somebody, Sheldon, do you have somebody in your newspaper back there who can write? Yucca Mountain, please. He'll call up, Yucca Mountain is okay. That's the end of that. That's the end of that. So Yucca Mountain, you're in great shape. Maybe they can finally report it properly. But we're reversing decades of calamitous trade policies. For years, Washington politicians took money from lobbyists, global corporations, and corrupt special interests to ship our jobs and factories. And all of this stuff and all of this wealth, they stole our wealth. They shipped it overseas and to other countries. America lost 1 in 4 manufacturing jobs following the twin disasters of NAFTA and China's entrance into the WTO, the World Trade Organization. Probably an even worse deal for us than NAFTA, if that's possible. But under my administration, the great betrayal of America is over. America is no longer for sale. Last month, we ended the NAFTA catastrophe, and I signed the brand new U.S.-Mexico-Canada agreement, USMCA. See, we played the song YMCA, because that's the only way you remember. Just think of the song YMCA. Think of the song, and you'll remember that. USMCA is a gigantic victory for farmers, ranchers, and manufacturers all across the great state of Nevada. I also took the strongest ever action to confront China's massive theft of American jobs. Our strategy worked. Last month, we signed a groundbreaking trade agreement, probably the biggest agreement of any kind ever signed, with China that will defend our workers, protect our intellectual property, and boost American exports by a lot. China will be buying $250 billion worth of goods from us now, and $50 billion from our farmers. My guys wanted 16. I said, make it 50. My guys wanted 16. They got China up to 20. I said, nope, got to make it 50. And then I said to China, you got 1.5 billion people. What difference does it make? They said, you're right. $50 billion. I don't think our farmers can produce that much, but we're going to soon find out. They're going to buy very large tractors. After years of building up other countries, we are finally rebuilding our country. We are finally putting America first. On no issue have Washington Democrats more thoroughly sold out the American people than the issue of immigration. Before I came into office, the far left's policy of open borders allowed deadly drugs to flow freely into our country, poisoning our children, including right here in a very, very big way, the great state of Nevada. Washington Democrats put the needs of illegal immigrants before the well-being of American citizens. You know that. You've been complaining about for a long time. It's one of the reasons you voted for Trump. They want to let anyone from around the world simply walk across the border. And then they want to give them a lifetime of free welfare, of health care, of lots of other things, including education, all paid for by the taxpayers of the United States. Illegal immigration costs Nevada taxpayers, think of it, more than $1.6 billion every year, over $1,500 per household. For the amount of money Washington Democrats want to spend supporting illegal immigrants, we could rebuild every city, all of these distressed areas in the United States, throughout our country. The money we spend, it's not even thinkable. And don't forget, when we say come, like in California, the clown, he says, come, come, we'll give you free health care. People that weren't even thinking about coming. That's why we have caravans of people that were turning back. Mexico's been great. By the way, they gave us 27,000 soldiers on our border. But when a governor Nice guy, actually. He's a nice guy. We just got to explain the facts of life. He's a nice guy. Oh, doctor, please. Doctor. Doctor in the house. Please. Medical, please. A doctor. Thank you. Thank you. Take your time. Take your time. We got plenty of time. Take your time, please. You know, a lot of these people have been here for 3 days. It's a lot. Those front row people are tough. They're tough. Right? Take your time, Doc. Take your time. Yeah. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, doctor. Thank you. That's true. They get here so they stand and sit and sometimes days early. In Colorado, they're there 3-4 days early. It's tough. It's tough. And we work it and make sure that you have everything you want. Number one, we cover the facts. And number two, we want to have a good time because we have to have a good time. You have to have a good time. But things like that happen a lot. Because after 2-3 days, it's not easy. And these are strong people. I'm not going to fight any of them, okay? Now, amazing people. Thank you very much. Thank you. Under my administration, we're finally taking care of our own citizens first, including millions and millions of legal immigrants who follow our laws, pay their taxes, lift up our society, and are entitled to a government that protects their families and protects their communities. Every day, Democrats' open border policies are harming and killing innocent people. You know what's happening. You know what's going on. In this region alone, last year, ICE officers and their patriots, their strong, tough patriots, if we didn't have them, they removed thousands and thousands of MS-13 gang members a year. And plenty of others. Who else is going to do it? ICE officers arrested over 5,000 criminal aliens, charged or convicted of dangerous offenses, including robbery, rape, and even murder, many murders. In western Nevada, an illegal alien, was charged with robbing and brutally executing four victims last year. Right here in Las Vegas, three MS-13 gang members abducted a man, tied him up with his shoelaces, shot him repeatedly, and hacked him to death with a machete. You know exactly what I'm talking about. It's right here in your place in Las Vegas. Right here. They hacked him to death, tied up and hacked him to death. Yet left-wing politicians oppose all detention of illegal aliens, even convicted criminals and murderers, and they support deadly sanctuary cities. You know, I say this all the time, and I just, how the hell, I mean, where are they coming from? I don't get it, right? Seriously, I don't get it. Sanctuary cities imperil American lives by releasing dangerous criminal aliens directly into your communities. If you want to shut down sanctuary cities, if you want to protect your family and your loved ones, you must vote Republican in 2020. Cool. And you have some great ones here, Michael. Thanks to our tireless efforts to secure the border, we have reduced illegal border crossings 8 straight months in a row. And as the wall gets longer, it gets easier and easier. Remember when the Democrats were saying, you don't need a wall. You know, two things that never change, right? All these computers, they said, use drones. Oh, great, we'll fly over with drones. Watch the people pour in by the thousands. That's great. Use drones. You know, before I came along, they all wanted a wall. They just didn't know how to build it. They had no clue. They had no clue. They had no clue. They had the money. They actually gave the money back. But they had no clue. But as soon as I came in and I said, wall, 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 they went against. And I made a terrible, terrible mistake. You know, they always say, I never admit mistakes. I do. But I'll admit a mistake now. I should have said, we will never, ever, under any circumstances, build a wall. They would have given me so much money for a wall you have built. They would have forced me to build it. I made a terrible mistake, right? Terrible mistake. So if it ever happens again, which it won't, this wall is one of a kind. We'll say, we will not build the wall. And they'll say, we demand that you build the wall, and it would have been so easy. Illegal crossings are down 75% since last spring, and we have ended catch and release. A horrible problem. We catch them. You know the story. They come over. Could be a killer, murderer, rapist. They come over. We can't do anything. We have to be politically correct. We catch them. We then say, what's your address? They don't know. They don't even know their country in many cases. Where do you come from? We don't know. And they mean it. But some are very serious criminals. So we catch them. We take whatever they can take, which is nothing. And then we had to release them in our country. We can't bring them back. And then we have a system of judges, thousands of judges all over the place. You got to be like Perry Mason. And everybody, every illegal that comes in, they have the lawyers, you know, the lawyers meet them, they get fees. They get paid fees. But we're breaking the system. No more catch and release. You think that was easy? And the big thing is that 30-foot, and this wall is built exactly to the specifications of Border Patrol, totally. And Border Patrol has seized the largest amount just recently of deadly narcotics ever recorded, the largest amount. We've deported record numbers of gang members. We've done more to secure the border than any administration in history. We are, as I said, building the wall faster than ever, faster and bigger than anyone thought possible. They can't believe we're getting it done. We'll have over 500 miles of wall built sometime next year, 500 miles. Washington Democrats have never been more extreme than they are right now. 132 congressional Democrats have now signed up for Bernie Sanders' takeover of health care, that would strip 180 million Americans, many of them in this room, of their private coverage. Remember President Obama? Remember? He said, you can keep your doctor, you can keep your plan, 28 times. He lied. So we should impeach him. We should impeach him. We're going to impeach him. We'll do a belated impeachment. We're going to do a belated impeachment. 28 times, you can keep your doctor, right? Remember, you can keep your doctor. You can keep, unfortunately, when they found out you can't keep your doctor, he said, I was just kidding. Now, we should impeach him. We'll do a belated impeachment, fake news. You have it? So you have to be very careful when you say impeach him, because you know what they do? They go back and they write. They write. President Trump said that Obama should be impeached, but he's not in office, and so therefore they can't impeach. He doesn't know what he's talking about, because he's not in office, so therefore they can't. So you have to be very careful. That's why I use the word belated impeachment. Belated, meaning I'm just kidding, okay? They do it all the time. They had it the other day. I said, bring back Gone with the Wind, right? I said, the movie. I said a little bit up here, but I said the movie. The other day in Colorado, I guess, I said, South Korean movie won. You know, they said, ladies and gentlemen, the winner of the Academy Award is, and it's a movie made in South Korea. I said, what's this all about? And I deal with them. They like me. We're helping them a lot. They're killing us on trade. You know, they beat us on trade, and then they win the Academy Award for a freaking movie. Right? But we redid that trade deal. But the other day, they got me on this one, too. I said, whatever happened to Gone with the Wind? That beautiful movie, Vivian Leigh, Clark Gable, right? Whatever happened, bring back Gone with the Wind. And some of them wrote, he doesn't know that that movie was made like in 1936. So anybody sitting, Jesus, fake news, it is fake news, they're fakers. But no, anybody sitting there reading, they're saying, man, Trump can't be that smart. You know, he said, bring back Gone with the Wind, that's an old movie, yeah. It's an old classic. Bring back, make, what I say is, make great movies, you know? Not this computerized crap, computerized garbage. And I was never a fan of Brad Pitt, I will tell you. No, I thought he was a stiff. He was like a stiff, you know? It's like a boring guy. All of a sudden, he wins the Academy. Whoa, it's a fitting. Their ratings aren't so good in the Academy Awards. You know when that stopped? When they started attacking us. Their ratings went right down the tubers. You know, I told somebody the evening newscast, you know, they're terrible for conservative people. And they're crooked. They're absolutely dishonest. I said to one of the big broadcasters, I'm friendly with them. I said, you know, if you ever did a conservative newscast, instead of have, you know, you got ABC is terrible, terrible. NBC is just absolutely atrocious. And they do badly. You know, not a lot of people are watching. They used to, well, we had the late, great Walter Cronkite and these legends, right? But ABC is terrible, and NBC is terrible, and CBS is terrible. They're all the same. And I said, you know, your ratings stink. If you would do a newscast that's conservative, I'd get them a host. I could recommend guys right now. Right? I'd get him a host. We'll call up. We'll call up. Don't take Sean Hannity away from us, please. Don't take our Sean. That's my problem. I don't want to take away any of our people. You get a Pete Hegseth. You get a Jesse Waters. You get... I mean, I could name so many of them, right? And you put them on that broadcast, their ratings would go up fivefold. But they don't know that. I don't know. They're stupid. They're stupid. They're stupid. Their ratings would go through the roof. But they would rather have a failed broadcast that nobody watches than put on a conservative person and lift the ratings five times. They would rather have a fail. Just like they were hoping 7 months ago, you know, we had a little skid. And they were hoping the market would crash because they would rather lose their money or big parts of it and have a really horrible market on the basis that we, not me, we could not be elected on November 3rd. This is how evil, this is how crazy they are. They've gone crazy. I guess you call it Trump derangement syndrome. But if they ever did a conservative broadcast, meaning very fair, very honest, but if it's almost like, when I say that, it's almost like do a fair broadcast, just a fair broadcast. That thing would be the hottest show, but they don't realize it. And if they do, they probably wouldn't do it anyway because they don't want to go away from what they're doing, which is crazy because it is, they are doing very poorly. While the social and socialist Democrats are trying to destroy American health care and your Social Security, they're putting it at risk. My administration is protecting your Social Security. Remember they said 4 years ago in the debates. And you had this crazy woman. I mean, I hate to mention her name. I did it, you know, yesterday. I threw all the rugs. Hate to. She's a zero, zero. She's got zero television personality. Zero. A.B. Stoddard, whoever that is. She said, Donald Trump lost all of his debates. I won every debate. And maybe, I don't know, maybe won somebody, but I won with tremendous number. He said, you always win. No, I'm not sure. We try, I'll tell you that. And we're winning now. But this crazy woman who's got zero going, zero. She said, Donald Trump lost his debates and he won. You know, she was talking about how badly Minnie Mike did. So she said, well, Donald Trump, no. I won every single debate. I won him against Crooked Hillary. I won him in the primaries, like 15 or 16 debates. And for some reason, you know, sometimes you do say, it's not a big deal. Nobody watches her. Nobody cares. Nobody even knows who she is. I just made her famous, right? She's nothing. She's nothing. She's got no talent. Got nothing. She's probably got a little drive. That's how she keeps getting on television. Other people don't have her drive. But you know what? I said, that's really unfair. So I took out the polls, Time Magazine, Drudge, good guy Drudge. Drudge, we took out a lot of different things, and we put up the Drudge poll, the Time Magazine poll, and many others. And some of them had me down like at 91%, and then they'd have many people. And I can't really show up because many of those people are now great friends of mine. Some of them are great Republican senators. I'm not going to show results, but I'm holding it up just quickly. Glancing, I call it a glancing blow. But we won the debates. And I have this fake news person saying, Donald Trump did very poorly in the debates. I won every debate, easily. I never did it before. Remember my first question. I said, Rosie O'Donnell. It was one of my best answers. Rosie O'Donnell, who violated the campaign finance laws as badly as anybody I've ever seen, and nothing happens to her, right? And yet, Inesh violated that. He made a little mistake. And they want to destroy him. So we pardoned him. We pardoned him. By the way, he made a mistake. Rosie O'Donnell, that was a massive violation of the campaign finance laws. But Dinesh D'Souza, they wanted to put him in jail. I don't know. I think he might have even gone to jail for a period of time for doing something that was really very understandable. Rosie O'Donnell, five times, what she did is incredible. Nothing happens. And then she gets on and says, what a bad guy I am. I'm not a bad guy. But it's really a disgrace. You know, it's a disgrace. I'm glad they didn't do anything with her, frankly, because you don't want to do for something like that. But you know what? How do they take it? We have two sets of justice in this country. It's no good. It's no good. It's no good. You know the thing we're working on right now. We're trying to get fairness for a certain person who's been treated very unfairly. A man who had a juror who was a radical anti-Trump person. And she didn't say that when she went up there. And she became the foreperson of the jury. And she did terrible things and said terrible things. And you know how they caught her? When he was convicted, and then a statement was made, she started jumping up and down, screaming, yes, yes, and started telling everybody how. They said, wait a minute, wasn't she just a juror? The woman was totally biased. How do you do this? So I fight. Look, I fight. A lot of times it's not worth it, but I got to fight for fairness. I got to fight for fairness. Got to fight for fairness. It's a very unfair system. I guess it's called the swamp. I just, you know, when I said drain the swamp, it was a nice phrase. I never liked the phrase. You know, when I was campaigning, somehow the phrase came up. Sir, I think we have a phrase, drain the swamp. I said, I don't like it. That's too hokey. But one day I was at a big arena, 25,000 people packed before the election. And I said, and we will drain the swamp. The place went crazy. I said, wow, you never know. You never know. Frank Sinatra said his best song, I won't tell you which one because I'll ruin it for you, but his best song is the song that he thought would never make it, the song that he liked the least. But he said that's the one that was the most successful, that the people like. You never know. So I said, drain the swamp, and the people went crazy. I said, whoa. I said, let's try that again. And the next time I did it again and again and again, I only didn't know how disgusting and dirty the swamp is, and a lot of the media is a big part of the swamp. So my administration is protecting your Social Security, your Medicare, and is fighting to give you great health care. We're defending your right to keep your doctor and your plan. We're defending that right. You're going to have that right back. We're going to cancel that Obamacare if we can win the case, and we're going to give you great health care. And we're making health care better and much cheaper, while premiums more than doubled in the last 5 years before I took office. We're managing it very well. We got rid of the individual mandate, by far the most unpopular thing, where you had to pay a lot of money for the privilege of not having to pay for bad health care, right? We got rid of it. And it was upheld in the Supreme Court, what we did. We get sued everything we do. If we move, if we take 10 steps right or left, we get sued. And we're now offering plans that are up to 60% less expensive. We're going to make health care a big part of this campaign. We're protecting people with pre-existing conditions that we always will. That's why if we are successful, you know, we're in the Supreme Court to try and get rid of this, the carcass. It's a carcass known as Obamacare. But we're running it much better than they did. Remember when they had, this was the greatest, the $5 billion website, right? $5 billion! It was supposed to cost $5 million. I have a son at home. He's 13. He's a genius with computers. Hi, Dad! What's up, Dad? Dad, get out of here. Hey, listen, I'm the President of the United States, Barry. Don't talk to you. Dad, come on, Dad. Can't you see I'm playing with my computer? The guy talks to me. He's working with his computer. These guys are genius. You know, they grow up with, like, walking, right? But he's looking at me. I could have given him their health care site. He would have done it for nothing, and it would have been better than what they have there. Remember? Come on, Dad. I'm busy, Dad. What do you want? What do you want, Dad? Barry. Whoa, Barron, whoa. Wow, they're gonna like, he's gonna like that. He liked it. He's a good boy. He's a tall boy, I'll tell you that. Just turned 13. He's up there. I'm saying, hi, Barron, how you doing? No, he's good, but they're great with the computers. And they spent $5 billion. Okay, it was gonna cost 50. It was gonna cost five. It was gonna cost 50. Then it was gonna... What was the final number? 500? The number was so... The number that they spent $5 billion, right? It ended up... It still doesn't work. They spent $5 billion, right? And they spent $500 million on all of the problems it caused. And we've really straightened it out. But it's still lousy health care, Obamacare. And it's really not Obamacare anymore, because when you get rid of the individual mandate, it's no longer Obamacare. But we're going to terminate it. We're going to give you your pre-existing 100%. Otherwise, I won't do it. We're going to give you brand new pre-existing. And we're going to have a great health care that's much less expensive. And we're fighting to stop surprise medical billing. And Barron's going to be very happy. Thank you. I signed an executive order imposing price transparency. Because when providers are required to show their prices, those same prices fall very fast. You know, a man that does this very professionally is great into the healthcare business. And you have to be careful when you say it, but, you know, it was just a very strong statement. He said, sir, price transparency in hospitals, where you can bid it out and you can look at the prices. Right now, you can't see. If you go to a hospital, they won't even tell you how much it's going to cost. They operate, and then they'll give you a bill, and you'll say, oh, my God, I had no idea it could be. They take blood. We have one person blood, $39, another place, the exact same thing, $2,500. Take blood, a blood test, One's $39, one's $2,500, the same test. Maybe the $39 test is better. Who the hell knows? But it's crazy. Price transparency. And he looked at me and goes, and he's a real pro, one of the top in the country. He said, sir, and nobody wanted to do it because it's a little bit controversial and a lot of the drug companies don't exactly love it. The hospitals don't love it. But I got to do what's right for the people. I don't care. I got to do it. But he looked at me, he said, and this is why I did it. It was one phrase. You know, do you ever do where you're not going to do something, and then somebody hits you with a perfect phrase? He said, sir, price transparency is bigger than healthcare. I said, what do you mean by that? He said, you will see numbers that far outweigh healthcare, hospitals, doctors. He said, you'll be able to price out everything. You'll be able to see costs. He said, price transparency. You know, people, if you've heard about this for 15, 20 years, no president has the guts to do it. And it probably means I won't get campaign contributions from certain people, but I'm not going to get them anyway. What the hell difference does it make? I don't want them. I don't want them. I got to do what's right. You know, we're here for a short period of time. Even if it's a long period, it's still a short period. And we got to do so. Price transparency is a big deal. He said it's bigger than healthcare. Think of that, bigger than healthcare. So let's see what happens. But that'll kick in, unfortunately, that kicks in after the election. Because we're going through the final stages. We're going through a statutory process, unfortunately. So think of it. We're going to win. But let's say the fake news can give me enough phony stories, enough bad stuff, that we don't make it. The new president will get all the credit for price transparency, and he won't even know what the hell it is. And I took the heat. Isn't that something? But we're going to win. We got to win for that reason alone. We've approved a record number of affordable new generic drugs, which are just as good as the name brand drugs, but a fraction of the cost. And that was another one. Tremendous political pressure. Think of it. You own Bayer Aspirin. You own all these name brand drugs. They're making so much money. And then a guy comes along and said, I want to make 20 forms of aspirin. They're exactly the same. Exactly. But they don't have a big name on it. Exactly as good. I don't say better. I don't say worse. They're exactly the same. You know, people still, they want to go out and buy the name. You know, I do, you know, because it's just because we're stupid. No, it's true. They're exactly the same. We're approving so many of the generic drugs, a record number. Nobody's ever approved so much. The drug companies hate it. They hate it. It's never happened like what we're doing. We also took down the trial periods from 12 years down to 5 or 6 years because they'd have a new drug. The thing was obsolete by the time it got approved. We've passed a really spectacular thing that they've been trying to get for 40 some odd years, right to try. So you don't have to now go if you get, hopefully nobody in this room has those kind of problems. Right to try. And so now you go and you sign a waiver and you get everything and it's great. If you're terminally ill, if you're very, very sick, you're not going to make it. And you know why they didn't do it? They wouldn't approve it because they didn't want to be sued. And they said, no, this could be dangerous. They said, the people are terminally ill. They're going to die. Let them use the experimental drugs. Don't wait. Because they have another 4 or 5 years before they can come onto the market. And it turned out we are having such unbelievable results. And you know what else? Some of those drug companies are now liking it. They fought me like crazy because it's really showing if it works there, it's really showing that it works. It's pretty amazing. Right to try. I hope you don't have to use it. We're combating the opioid epidemic. Drug overdose deaths have declined for the first time in nearly 31 years. And I've launched new, and this is really something, brand new initiatives combating kidney disease and combating Alzheimer's disease. We've made a lot of progress. We've made a lot of progress, Sheldon. And we're pursuing new advances in the neonatal research to care for America's youngest patients, our babies, and breaking all records in so doing. All of the radical Democrats in the presidential debates have declared their unlimited support for extreme late-term abortion, ripping babies straight from the mother's womb right up until the very moment of birth. This is why in my State of the Union address, did you like it? Good. That's a different kind of address. You know, we can go lots of different ways, right? Presidential, not presidential. If I was presidential, totally, you'd have about three people standing here. But I asked Congress to prohibit late-term abortion of babies because Republicans believe that every child is a sacred gift from God. The Democrat Party is the party of high taxes, high crime, open borders, late-term abortion, socialism, blatant corruption, and the total obliteration of your very, very important Second Amendment. The Republican Party is the party of the American worker, the American family, the American dream, and the late, great Abraham Lincoln, which everybody forgot. Republicans are fighting for citizens from every background, every community, and every single walk of life. We are the party of boundless optimism, excitement, energy, and enthusiasm. We are wealthy, right? We are. Are we enthusiastic? You know how many of these I've done in the last 4 days? People say, where the hell do you get your energy? I say, well, the truth is, I like what I do. And if we weren't getting the results, I wouldn't like it. If we weren't getting the results, if I didn't see the results, I wouldn't like it at all. We're welcoming Americans of all parties and political persuasions to join our incredible movement to make America great again. We're a very big party. We are the party of big ideas for the future. Republicans are fighting for school choice because no parent should ever be forced to send their child to a failing government school. I passed criminal justice reform to give former prisoners a second chance at life. It was never going to happen. We got it done. This could not have been done by anyone but the Republican Party and ourselves. You know, the Democrats have tried for years. They couldn't get it done. We got it done. To uphold the rule of law, we are confirmed. And this is something they say most important thing you can do, judges. I say most important thing is defense. Second is judges. A record number of 217 federal judges who will interpret the Constitution as written. And we have appointed two great new Supreme Court justices, Neil Gorsuch and Brett Kavanaugh. I recognized Israel's true capital and opened the American embassy in Jerusalem. And we recognized Israeli sovereignty over the Golan Heights. We have invested $2.2 trillion to rebuild the United States military, including more than $130 million for Nellis Air Force Base right here. And we just created the sixth branch of the American Armed Forces, the Space Force, 72 years. 72 years. The Air Force was 72 years ago. We just did a branch. It's a big deal, isn't it? Think of it, a branch. The Army, the Air Force, think of it. We did a branch. For years, you watched as your politicians apologized for America. Now you have a president who is standing up for America, and we are standing up for the people of Nevada. At stake in our present battle is the survival of our nation. If you want your children to inherit the blessings that generations of Americans have fought and died for to secure, then we must devote everything we have toward victory in November of 2020. November 3rd. November 3rd. Only this way can we save the America we love. and drain the Washington swamp once and for all. With your help, we will lift millions more of our citizens from welfare to work, dependence to independence, and poverty to prosperity. Together, we will elect a Republican Congress to create a fair, safe, sane, and lawful system of immigration. We will continue to enact new trade deals that result in more products proudly stamped with that very beautiful phrase, made in the USA. We will achieve new breakthroughs in science and medicine, finding new cures for childhood cancer and ending the AIDS epidemic within 9 years in America. And we will land the first woman on the moon and become the first nation in the world to plant its flag on Mars. We will defend privacy, free speech, religious liberty, and the right to keep and bear arms. And that is under siege, in case you haven't noticed. You know, your Second Amendment is under siege. Just don't worry. Long as I'm here, they're not touching it. Above all, we will never stop fighting for this. So true. But we will never stop fighting for the sacred values that bind us together as one America. We support, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. We stand with the incredible heroes, and they are heroes. We love them. Of law enforcement. We believe in the dignity of work and the sanctity of life. We believe that faith and family, not government bureaucracy, are the true American way. We believe that children should be taught to love our country, honor our history, and to always respect our great American flag. And we live by the words of our national motto, In God We Trust. From Carson City to Reno, to right here in Las Vegas, we stand on the shoulders of red-blooded American patriots who poured out their heart, sweat, and soul to secure our liberty and to defend our great, beautiful, lovely freedom. 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 Freedom! Nevada was founded by pioneers and prospectors, miners and cowboys, who tamed the frontier, raised the mighty Hoover Dam, that's a beauty, transformed the barren desert into a shining oasis, lit up the lights of the Las Vegas Strip, and helped to make this the greatest nation ever to exist on the face of the earth, and we are making it greater than ever before. Proud citizens like you help build this country, and together we are taking back our country. We are returning power to you, the American people. With your help, your devotion, and your drive, we are going to keep on working, we are going to keep on fighting, and we are going to keep on winning, winning, winning. We are one movement, one people, one family, and one glorious nation under God. America is thriving like never before. And ladies and gentlemen of Nevada, the best is yet to come. Together we will make America wealthy again. We will make America strong again. We will make America proud again. We will make America safe again. And we will make America great again. Thank you very much, everybody. Thank you. Thank you, Nevada. Thank you, Las Vegas. We love Las Vegas. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.